Major, Trump said after last week's debate that he knew there was another debate scheduled and said he was pretty much okay with being part of it. What changed?
Well, Trump has been literally all over the map on this debate all week, trying to persuade people who ought to know better that he didn't know anything about this debate. He took four questions about this debate last Friday when Ben Carson endorsed him. You can check the transcript. And he had already suggested that he was open to this debate. But what's changed is this. Donald Trump now sees himself as, if not the presumptive nominee, the clear front runner. And you can already begin to see no press conference last night, even though one was announced. No debate attendance on Monday, even though he'd suggested he was willing to attend. A Rose Garden strategy, meaning he's not president. He doesn't have a Rose Garden, but he is running as a cautious incumbent, trying to avoid scenarios that pose any particular risk. Press conferences pose a risk. Debates pose a risk. And there's no scheduled events for Trump for the remainder of this week. So he is taking a break from the trail and also avoiding scenarios that put himself and his lead in this delegate hunt in pursuit of the nomination at potential risk.
Major, you mentioned that Trump warned of riots if he lost the nomination at a contested convention. With those remarks and pulling out of the debate, he really seems to be almost taunting or daring the RNC at this point.
Well, he's certainly projecting this message. I've got a lot of votes. I'm leading in the delegates, and there better not be any funny business on the floor of the convention in Cleveland. And there are no actual plans as of yet to conduct funny business, but Donald Trump can read as well as anyone else. And when he sees John Boehner, the former Speaker of the House, float the idea of Paul Ryan being a acceptable compromise choice at a contested convention in Cleveland, well, that sort of sets a lot of things in motion, at least on the theoretical side of what may or may not happen in Cleveland. And what Trump was trying to argue is, look, if I don't get 1237, that is the majority plus one of the available delegates, and this becomes a contested convention, he says, look, if I'm just 100 delegates short, I should get it. And if I don't, all the people who voted for me, all the people whose delegates are pledged to me, are going to walk out of that convention. So it's essentially telling the Republican Party something I guarantee you those in the establishment ranks already know. If you're going to fight over this nomination and try to deny it of Donald Trump, you have one of two choices. Fight him now, or fight him on the floor of the convention, but realize you may lose that fight and in the process drive a lot of people who have recently come to the party behind Trump's banner out.
Yeah, there's definitely no going back if that's an option. Let's talk about this. Ted Cruz and Donald Trump have been calling for Marco Rubio to leave the race for days now. They got what they wanted on Tuesday night. How does that change the dynamic?
Well, it creates a new dynamic, Elaine, in that we don't know, number one, where those Rubio votes are going to go. John Kasich is certainly going to make a play for them, and Ted Cruz will as well. Now, there are many in the Republican ranks who I've talked to today who think Ted Cruz is a little bit too archly conservative to attract Marco Rubio's supporters, and that they believe John Kasich is a much more natural place for those voters to land. And in future primary states like Pennsylvania, Maryland, Delaware, New York, regionally fit for John Kasich and those who might have been inclined to support Marco Rubio. But we had a fresh example today in South Carolina where Nikki Haley, the sitting governor who had endorsed Marco Rubio, didn't endorse Ted Cruz, but said she was much more aligned with him. So all of this stuff is up for grabs. And both campaigns are trying to make a play for the supporters and the financing behind them, because everyone needs to raise money and attract support to stay in this race. Interestingly, John Kasich had enough money to put up ads, two brand new 30-second ads in Utah in advance of Tuesday's contest. And that's something we haven't seen before, where Kasich, in very quick sequence, can cut ads, put them up, and pay for them in states as the primary calendar unfolds. That suggests he is, in fact, raising money enough to be relevant and credible in this process.
All right. Major Garrett in Washington for us. Major, thank you so much.
You got it.